welcome to a brand new episode of Sequel Rights, the podcast where we take a look at the franchises that make you go, they made how many of those? And we give each and every sequel a fair trial. My name is Justin Camps, and I'm here with...
Elizabeth Helly.
And...
the lawgiver, Tyler Hymanson.
Wow, okay.
Whoa, this guy is the lawgiver. He's the first ape to speak. Whoa. Okay, guy. Mama. Oh, boy. All right. We are back with more Planet of the Apes this week. I hope you've been enjoying our episode so far with the original Planet of the Apes with Brian Pennecost and the episode for Beneath the Planet of the Apes with the filmmakers from Trust.
Yeah.
It's been great so far, and here we are talking Escape from the Planet of the Apes, and we have another great guest who we have interview at the end of the episode, actually, with Hunter Goatley, who runs Hunter's Planet of the Apes Archive, which is an amazing website. And you can hear all about it after this episode ends.
He has an amazing resource of all these high-res scans and all this behind-the-scenes footage.
It's crazy.
Very much worth checking out.
In a good way, yeah. So tune in to that at the end of this episode.
Yep.
Thanks for being here. And before we get too far into things, Eliz, where can people reach out to us?
Yeah, I mean, we've been having so much fun so far jumping into a big, meaty series like this with lots of fandom. So email us your thoughts, questions, opinions to sequelrights@gmail.com or reach out on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube at sequelrights.
And rate and review wherever you're listening, Spotify, the podcast app on Apple, and... if you've already done that, then go share out old episodes that you might have enjoyed. I recommend diving back into our Starship Troopers if you're out there playing Helldivers.
Yeah.
Chucky is on the horizon. Mm-hmm. Lots of fun stuff. If you've seen that image of Chalamet walking around New York looking like Fievel Maskowitz, I recommend going back to our American Tales series.
Yeah. Oh, I just want to mention too, on YouTube, I don't think we mentioned this because I didn't want to promise it then, but I did upload the interview with Brian Pennecost's video version to YouTube. You can see his amazing like ape masks and what he was referring to in the interview gesturing to. He like holds up the guy's head and points out the different parts of the makeup. And so you can see that all on our YouTube channel.
Awesome.
Very cool.
Well, as mentioned, we're here talking about the third film in the Planet of the Apes series, part of the original series as well here, Escape from the Planet of the Apes, which was out in 1971. As we go through, you'll get to hear what people were thinking about back then. But in the meantime, here is the trailer. Let's get into it.
This is Dr. Zira, her loving husband, Cornelius. And little Milo. The most dangerous to man is little Milo. Why? The time is 1973. The place is right here on Earth. How did they get here? What is their reception?
Welcome, gentlemen, to the United...
Escape from the Planet of the Apes. Their adventures are completely fresh, completely new. Astonishingly different from what you experienced in Planet of the Apes and beneath the Planet of the Apes. At first, feared and imprisoned.
We'll take the female first.
Yes. Hey. Astonishingly different.
United Apes.
That trailer goes on for another
How
like,
did he become Little Milo?
He's a little doctor.
It was all...
little... No, they're talking about the baby.
It was all the bullets.
Oh, the baby. I was like, what are they talking about?
Spoiler alert, they're talking about
that
the baby.
That guy was a doctor.
Spoiler, they're talking about the baby, and spoiler alert, they shoot that baby.
Yeah.
Or do they?
Okay, so, yeah, this movie, we tried to predict how they would do another movie, and I don't think any of us got it quite right on the nose.
No. For those of you who might just be hopping in,
right,
and maybe like you know haven't heard our previous episode of Beneath the Planet of the Apes, the film.
Go back and listen to them.
Spoilers for that film. It ends with Earth exploding.
Yep.
In a couple lines of dialogue.
Yeah. The nuclear bomb destroys the entire planet.
Yep. Yep. The end.
Much like Oppenheimer predicted.
Yeah. Right. The atmosphere.
Yes.
It ignited. Yeah.
Near zero.
But so we were all, we had all talked about early on too about how we hadn't like fully remembered all these, you know, early films.
We're like, we're going to see Ape Circus. We're going to see ape like gladiatorial nonsense.
And that all got wiped away with the last film. And so how is this one going to start? How's it going to start? It's going to start completely differently with, you know.
We see a chopper.
Yeah.
A
chopper.
That first shot, you're immediately like, what?
Yeah. Yeah. And they're like, you kind of see something.
Do they get a broadcast of MASH across the universe?
You see something floating out in the ocean. You're like, what is that? Get a little closer. Holy shit, it looks like one of the ships from the original film.
Yeah.
Okay, what's going on there?
So I think we had discussed the possibility that somebody would make it off. And it was likely it would be the chimps because they were not there for the... they were on the planet. But they were not nearby when the bomb was going off, so...
So technically, Eliz, the beginning of this movie is the end of the story that this is based on. Like it was the apes, book? The book, all the apes were astronauts.
They just send the astronaut guy back to Earth. They don't like blow up the whole planet as far as we know.
Oh no, what I meant is that the reveal is that the astronauts that find the message in the bottle
are apes. Also apes. Yes. But they I don't think they were particularly escaping. They were just tourists.
No, yes. Yeah. But it was just Tyler, you're supposed to think these are astronauts.
They're canonically apestronauts.
Apestronauts.
I mean, they say that multiple times in the
That's
movie.
True.
Yeah. I mean, did you even watch the movie?
So it's very silly because there's military people. They come, they take them out, and then they're treating them like regular people, but like you have to assume that they're going to be aliens of some kind, and they're just so shocked for some reason when they turn out to be apes.
Well, I gotta say, like, this whole opening sequence, and honestly, for me, like, the entire concept of what this movie is genius.
Yes.
I love it.
Yes.
The spoiler alert, we have Jerry Goldsmith back.
Yes.
And he's used to great effect immediately in this opening sequence. The whole opening is, like, all just like no score. It's all sound effects. You hear all just like the military, the police coming up. Like everyone's like, what's going on? Da, 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 da. They pull in the ship. You just hear it being pulled in. It's just all very quiet and everything natural sounding. And it's like, yeah, the astronauts get off. They all have like black, like you cannot see their faces.
Yeah, yeah.
It's obvious that it's going to be something weird. Like, I didn't know for sure it was
aliens. Yeah, like, why wouldn't they think it would be aliens? Like, but anyway.
Well,
yeah.
I think it's because it's literally...
There's an American ship.
Yeah.
It is literally Taylor's ship.
But then why would they say, welcome to the United States, and instead of just saying, welcome home?
Well, yeah.
Because they knew Taylor was going somewhere. We don't actually know what Taylor's mission was.
All right.
Yeah, and it was three of them, so they're kind of like, that's the three guys. Okay, fine.
But anyway, they were more surprised than they should have been, in my opinion.
They were like, oh my God, that mummified lady's not here? We were hoping to have sex with her.
They definitely were thinking that.
She was going to be our Eve!
Yeah, but so you talked about Jerry Goldsmith, and this music cue that comes in immediately.
So great. Like they take the masks off and it's immediately like this kind of like jaunty, but kind of got a little bit edge to it. Like almost like a fun spy movie theme or something with a little bit of like surf.
It's
rock
interesting. I at first I was like, I hate this. It's over the top. It's making fun of everything. I wish they had just played it straight. But then I think I kind of came around to being like, actually the music is what makes it satirical.
Yes.
Yeah. Because that's all that it is.
So I have thoughts on this as we progress, but we won't get into it. But also Jaunty Edge is our band name.
Jaunty Edge. I just like watched it twice actually because I just loved because it goes right into like a title sequence and you get this these amazing like, you know, Roddy McDowell and you see all their reactions. I just love their reactions of like them being just as shocked because like we learn throughout the film that they're also like, what the fuck happened? Like, why are there people here? It's so weird. And I just loved like Roddy McDowell, Kim Hunter. You don't get the introduction to the other guy, but like, I just love that it was like the title sequence and it was all like kind of wordless and just getting to see the parade of like what the heck is happening and them dealing with these apes.
It's very cool, and this is a soundtrack that should get the full red carpet treatment
of
a vinyl release.
I wish. Someday. Mm.
So should your new nickname be Wisconsin Multiphasic?
The Wisconsin Multiphasic. Yeah, I looked that up, and I was like, I don't know if that's actually
a thing. I don't think it's a real thing. Or it's a combination of a bunch of different psychological
tests. Yeah, there's a Minnesota Multiphasic.
Yeah.
And so, but it's copywritten. So maybe they were like, we can't say that. Yeah.
Different. But yes, they immediately throw him into the zoo.
Yes. Which is why now you might understand why I was like, did we ever get that guest from the zoo? Did
they I know. I tried. So we have so many great guests, but none of them are zoologists.
My favorite part about this is that we talked about how the first two films do a fantastic job of making it feel like an alien planet. But for Los Angeles natives, which we are technically are at this point, Elis actually is.
Yes.
You know, it's very clearly just things, famous shooting locations around the town.
Yeah.
And so when they land, it's not New York where Taylor is supposed to be. They land randomly in Santa Monica. And they're immediately driven to the LA Zoo, which if you watch this movie, it looked depressing in the 70s and it looks depressing now.
Yeah. I was like, I want to go there and see if we can get our photo in front of the zoo infirmary sign. Yeah. He's probably not actually there.
I doubt they want the guests walking to the infirmary. Yeah.
Look, guys, we're
here. We could definitely go to the old LA Zoo that looks more like Ape City.
City. But yeah, I thought that was really funny. It was just like, oh, so we're admitting that it's Los Angeles now.
This whole opening sequence is just great. Like watching them walk through everything in their like ape suits, and then the guy, the general, like one of the funniest moments, the general walks in, and he sees that they're like, you know, changing clothes, and it's just like, you know, he has some reaction to, like, and goes like, wait, why the hell was I even asking that? Like, these are apes. Like, what the heck? Like,
it's so very funny. Weird that they immediately assume that they're just apes. And even though they're like putting on clothes, they've got a suitcase, they're trying to hide their talking, but then they kind of just give it up right away.
Yeah.
Zira can't hold it in. You know, women. It's pretty great. It's pretty funny.
But. So, like, there's a thing that's happening here that I think is really fascinating in that it is this high sci-fi concept where they are inversing the entire two movies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love it.
And then they are setting up these two main characters for basically a sitcom scenario.
Yeah.
Yep.
Where like America loves the apes.
Yeah.
And it's the like apes are here.
Alf or Gary
Anderson. And there's points of it where it's like the TV medium like permeates this film where there's literally applause breaks for the studio audience where like the apes come there. And it's very interesting where it gets there eventually. Of the all of the criticisms that were baked into the first film and having those inverted and making them more clear. But there's like 15 to 20 minutes in the center of this movie where it's basically the Mork and Mindy pilot.
I have one of those applause moments here for you, Tyler.
Does the other one talk?
Only when she lets me.
I was like, you know what's the one universal thing between man and ape? This woman's the ball and chain.
Elis, did you know that they're wedded?
Wedded?
I did love the. Are you going to talk about the priest?
I was talking about hilarious. Like he was only there for that.
Those two jokes,
but it was like generals, politicians, Catholic priest. Although that's the same thing that happens in Ghostbusters, so I don't know.
And they're like, father, whatever. Yeah. We'll deal with that part later.
Yeah,
don't worry about it.
It's interesting because if you ever have to like study or think about, you don't have to be an expert, but once you start thinking about film critically or working on any sort of film or television, you immediately start seeing all the things that every property has done to cut the budget.
Yes.
And this one is just so well done that it makes sense and it all fits in this super high concept, but at the same time, they're like, you know what? We all live in LA. We're all film executives and we all think jokes about LA are funny. So it takes place in LA now. It makes fun of the entertainment industry. There's only three apes and most of the movie only two apes. And, you know, that's how we're saving on the budget.
That's why I feel like it's so like It's, I really think that is genius. Like, whoever came up with this idea.
Because it cuts down the budget, but it also makes so much sense for the story.
Yeah, which, you know, I think Paul Dane, the screenwriter, is the one who kind of, like, figured out, cracked how to, like, continue the story after what he did in the previous film. And it's just so great. Like, and, you know, obviously it was, like, for budgetary reasons and everything, but there's so many great story reasons and layers to it and, like Tyler said, one of my favorite things is like the inversion of like, now it's their turn to be like, oh God, we're like, we're on a planet of, you know, we joked about how the other one was called Planet of the Humans or whatever. And in a previous draft. And now it's like, just so fun to see them go like, oh my God, like we got to watch these humans pretend like they have jobs and stuff. Like this is so weird to see.
I have a grand unifying theory about why this series does not get the play that it deserves and why so far I would say that through movies in, it's been impressive to us. And I think that this is a movie that came out of the television era. Like, we start with a script from Rod Serling. We have all of these writers that have been bouncing around since the 50s doing these things. And this is a series that allows them to emerge and experiment and do all these different things. And I think that at the time, it was hard to distinguish between what was happening in TV, what was happening here. And, you know, there's applause breaks and... like, it kind of permeates the border there.
Yeah.
But I think that in TV, you had the highest iteration, the highest frequency of talent, like, emerging. And I think that for whatever reason, this series allowed that to emerge. And that's why it was wildly popular, why it was completely imprinted in all our brains, and why the particulars are completely forgotten. Because people thought it was disposable at that time, where really it was just the incubator of 20 years of TV writing of all these guys coming out being like, look, like here's what's happening in comics. Here's what's happening in sci-fi. Here's what's happening in literature. And so far, each one of these movies has made a really incredible, bold choice that has surprised me.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really great. And they talk a little bit about this, that kind of idea in the, like, there's a little short special feature on the Blu-ray that talks about the, you know, amazing acting of Kim Hunter and Roddy McDowall and how, like, you know, Kim Hunter literally had an Academy Award previously to this. And they were like, you know, they were talking about how, like, you don't win, you know, at this time, like, you don't win awards for being in a movie like this or something, but like they're like her amazing acting ability is like coming through so much, like in Roddy McDowell's too, in their eyes and like emoting through all that makeup and stuff, like that if something like that came out today, people would be like, this is an amazing performance that needs to be recognized, and there would be all these like,
yeah, look at Poor Things, just with the piece on his face.
Exactly, like, or people behind all sorts of makeup and prosthetics, or it's like
my counterpoint is Zoe Saldana, but yes. The most forgotten woman in Hollywood. But yeah.
The most wealthy woman.
And she, I know. Again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I forgot what I was gonna say.
Sorry.
Anyway.
That's all right. Well, you know, we get introduced to the scientist characters, or they're kind of like psychiatrists.
Oh, yeah. So they have like, so that's what shocked me about this too, which is kind of sad because today our politicians, our presidents, any president, like our people that would be on this kind of panel, none of them, not a single one, would react as good as the people in this movie reacted. I was waiting for them to be like, we gotta kill these apes, we gotta do that, we gotta do this. But all of them are actually so woke and so fair to them. There's a little ha-ha, like they can't believe it at the beginning. But they immediately, all except for this one, you know, scientist who goes off the deep end, everybody else is basically like, no, like these are creatures who are sentient, they have rights, we can only do so much to them, and we also torture animals all the time, so we shouldn't punish them because they tortured humans in their world.
So this is, so I have, I mean, we could have an entire podcast about this dynamic, But this is after JFK's assassination. Mm. This is right around the Civil Rights Act. And my favorite part of this is the president briefs the generals. Mm-hmm. He briefs the military.
Yeah.
On like, you need to believe this.
Yeah.
And they're all like, harumph, harumph, harumph. And he's like, no, you got to believe it. Like, sorry.
It just is so crazy how, like, the office of the president in general has just become, like, I don't think you ever see, like, a good president on TV anymore. No. But this guy was, like, very sensible.
Camelot, baby.
There's a whole, like, frankly, like, really high, like, really great and amazing sequence and conversation between the main, like, presidential advisor, mm-hmm. Dr. Otto Haslein, and the president. Where I was just like the whole time, I was like, can you imagine like a president being like this astute and like having all these like great comments and like thoughtful interpretations of like
believe it.
And arguments with what he's saying? Like, I was just like, the president is not like this.
No,
not to our knowledge.
Well, and even Haslein, who turns out to be our villain and ultimately decides he's got to kill the apes, he starts out pretty open-minded.
Yeah. Oh, I have a.
He's the only one who believes about the time travel.
I have a grand overarching theory, and the casting kind of confirms this in my mind, is that like he's Oppenheimer in this movie. Mm. And Oppenheimer was in that time a great educator and was on these shows and talking about those things.
Right.
And there was a time where there was scientific education on news programs and things like that. And there is a really beautiful, and maybe you'll hear this in the interview that we talk about at the end of this episode, but that this film has everything that's good about humanity and everything that's bad. And I would say that the thing that this movie does that is the most interesting is that the second act is all positivity. It's like, here's everything that humans are good at. Here's, you know, we embrace the apes. We make them celebrities. We do these things that this Oppenheimer character is talking about. I believe them. They're credible. I'm enlightening the world about how this is possible. And then through a comedy of errors and some hate, it all devolves. And I think that there's something really powerful about that for this movie, as much as it feels like a TV movie.
Yeah, it's interesting because ultimately they make friends with the two doctors whose names I'm
Stevie and
Dixon. Try to help them escape, but I feel like if they had just gone public, the public would have protected them because they were so well liked after, you know, being on TV, and he was going to christen a new boat at the Jungle Cruise at Disneyland. Right. Yeah. I was like, and you know, they had the whole like Pretty Women montage and this party and all these things, you know, but there's just this one guy who, once he hears, you know, what happens, is like, we gotta kill these apes. But yeah, if they had just gone to the public, like, obviously you don't do it for the movie, but like, yeah, the public would have been like, you can't kill them, they're great, I love that guy. People do
make that argument.
I feel like they do. Yeah. Then they're like, we have to hide them for mm-hmm. that.
Well, because there's that whole, I love that whole argument about like, and they talk a little bit in the special features about the biblical themes, but like, you know, the president brings up like the idea of like Herod trying to kill, you know, trying to get rid of Jesus, and that didn't work for him. And like, and how he became like, you know, historically unpopular.
Yeah. So,
and he's just focused on, you know, winning the next election. It doesn't matter. Like, do you actually think that killing these people is going to stop what's happening? You know?
Yeah.
It's crassly political while also being like weirdly humane.
Yeah.
And it feels weird. Doesn't feel like the place that we live right now.
Mm-hmm. I know. It's like people don't.
And that makes me sad.
Think like this. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was personally waiting for that Jungle Cruise scene to happen because
I know
they list out like, here's everything that they're going to be doing the next day. And then the next scene is literally like them doing all those things, except we don't see the Jungle Cruise.
It would have been great. If only 20th Century Fox had been part of Disney at that time. Yeah, let's take a minute to talk about our sponsor today. Grape Juice Plus.
Grape Juice Plus.
I love
Grape Juice Plus. Let's all have a sip of Grape Juice Plus, guys.
The moment in the film where he tells her that there's nothing wrong with drinking it, you know, to while you're pregnant made me pause it and go like, when did we?
I looked it all
when
up.
When did we know this?
So it was discovered in 1973 that alcohol was bad for pregnant women.
After this movie came out.
Yeah. And then the Surgeon General did not actually like lay it down as law until 1980.
Yeah.
However, in 1964 is when they realized smoking was bad for pregnant women. So weirdly, somehow that happened first. But yeah. So he was actually not being a huge dick by saying that.
Right.
He was earnestly thinking.
The way it was played out, it felt like, oh, this is actually what they really, it didn't feel like he was like tricking her in that moment. That's why I paused to like look. And,
right.
Because it felt like he was just stating it as a matter of fact, like, no, it doesn't do anything.
Again, this gets back to like in the previous movie, which is like, she got punched in the face. Is that, are we supposed to feel bad about that? Or is that just a thing? Like,
Yeah. But Grape Juice Plus is a great... Is a great
great sponsor. We highly recommend it.
Yeah, go buy it now.
Yeah, I just love that. And it continues out. He's like, this has the same effect as Grapefruit Plus.
Grape Juice Plus. Yeah.
Grapefruit Plus. Yeah, sodium pentothal.
That's the new streaming service.
Yeah.
Grape Juice Plus. Stream the wine into my veins.
Stream it. But yeah, the other amazing budget consideration is this just now takes place in present day, which was present day for them at the time.
Indeed.
Which they didn't really have to go that way. They could have, you know, come up with some other thing. They could have gone back to the cavemen era or, you know, gone back to, you know, whatever.
I have to say, okay, so I love that point, and I want to talk about, like, kind of my disappointment with this choice and also... Like,
I don't want to hear it.
The boldness of it.
Kidding.
Like, because, like, I think that where this leads to is that the humans nuked the apes, right? And I think that the implication in the first movie is that we sent ourselves back to the Stone Age, and that's how the apes evolved.
Right.
And this adds a layer to that that I think is interesting, but not as interesting as that first concept.
You're talking about the extreme lore drop that we get? Like,
well, yeah, I mean, we have to talk about that. Like, once they start getting grilled by Hassline
and
the military
11.
Guy. Yeah, Camp 11. Camp 11, interesting. that was weird. Yeah, he gets
no polar bears.
Huge lore dump on just the history of what happened, and time will tell, these future movies will tell if they kind of stick to that, if they deal with like they're changing the future, or it was all always going to happen this way. We'll have to find out.
I loved that, like, part of what he says is like what happens in like the newer films,
right?
A little bit, which are probably based on
that. Was one of the things that I was really impressed by in the first LA Zoo sequence that they end up in.
Yeah,
the cages that they're in are basically an exact replica from the first film.
Yeah.
Like, they're replicating that entirely. And it made me something I didn't know. It was an echo that was very cool.
Yeah. It was interesting, too. We kind of skipped over this, but their traveling companion, the guy who figured out how to fly the ship, he immediately gets killed by a gorilla.
Yes.
And there are a couple of times when mostly Zira, is saying like, oh no, not gorillas, like blah, 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 you know, and saying like, and someone at some point says to her like, you know what, we don't really care about your racial divides in your society.
Like, well, because she keeps going like, the chimpanzees didn't have anything to do with this. It's only the gorillas and the orangutans. Yeah.
There's a part of this that is interesting. There's a part of it that is maybe regressive, where they're talking about how cultural and class divides are intractable.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, like you're more evolved, you understand these things, but like you still are racist as shit. And there's a part of that that's like,
it's just up to interpretation.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying about like, because they kind of retconned the maybe the origin of the apes, although they never really explained.
No, they never said what the law, like they talked about the lawgiver giving them the scrolls, but yeah.
But they made it,
this whole thing about the dog and cat plague.
Yeah.
But in my mind, the first films is that humans annihilated each other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like it was Cold War nonsense.
Right.
This explanation doesn't make it seem like it was all bombs in the end. It's like, correct. Oh, the apes rose up on their own. And
so we had to do that. We're like, it feels like that the emotional core of the classic Charlton Heston ending is that like Russia and the United States finally did it. Like midnight happened and nuclear apocalypse.
Yeah.
Happened.
Well, it did still happen. Like, we just never knew who the supposed enemy of the United States was in that situation. And yeah, I mean, it could have just been the apes. Yeah.
But there's a part of the sci-fi explanation that, like, I guess the premise of these movies are based off of, to me, like, the reality of that happening, and so like some of the piss was taken out of that in this movie.
I guess I kind of enjoyed the idea that the apes like learned through domestication.
And
it was kind of
no,
like,
it's cool.
It's like, oh yeah, that's like what happened with dogs and cats, like they say, you know, over many years from wolves and everything. And so it makes sense that like it could maybe also happen with a different species.
And in the context of this, it makes more sense and it's more interesting. But like, at that time, that idea felt more scary to me.
And then, this will come into play later when we get into the other films, but it turns out that, like, the first ape that spoke said no.
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 Yeah.
Mama.
Which
the first ape said mama.
Yeah, that's true. They're already changing the time loop.
Indeed.
So Zira's pregnant. She said she was already pregnant before they even left their planet, quote unquote. And so this is really interesting because it's kind of what kicks Hasline into high gear, finding out that she's pregnant, because then he's kind of like, well, wait, like if different, those two were married, they, in his mind, they weren't going to screw any of these apes that are here on Earth already, but that are not sentient, but this baby, you know, what might happen if it breeds? And yeah, he starts freaking out about things. And, you know, it's interesting because obviously we don't like him. He's trying to kill our heroes that we like. But he gives this big diatribe about, like, when are we going to deal with this? I understand you're saying it takes thousands of years, but, like, that's what we say about everything. Like, when are we going to deal with pollution? You always say later. Yeah. And I was like, oh, it hurts.
Oh, no.
It hurts.
Yeah.
It's everything's like 50 later. Years later since this movie came out, and we still haven't done it. Oh.
Yeah. Like, how much time does the Earth have?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, seriously.
So
he's actually probably one of the best villains I've seen in a movie in a long time.
He's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
By the way, I didn't even notice this, but he is the villain in Herbie Goes to Monte Carlo.
What?
I did notice this.
Yeah. I looked it up, but I did not recognize him at all. I was like, oh, yeah, you know.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
There was a moment where I had actually, like, watch this in a few different sittings because, you know, I've got a kid and I just always fall asleep. So I had skipped to one of the scenes, like, which is the when they go to Camp 11 and they're getting interrogated.
Mm-hmm.
And I skipped to the scene and it starts, like, in total blackness with just, like, Zira talking. And I kept thinking, like, something's wrong with my disc. Like, why isn't there anything happening here? But it's that hilarious moment where they're first getting interviewed and she's, like, talking about there was a blinding white light. And then the guy who's like interrogating them, and he's like, was it brighter than this? And like flips the lights on and they're like, oh God.
Like, yes, it was. Yes, sir, it was.
I just thought that was a funny moment.
Yeah.
Indeed.
But one other thing. Oh yeah. So it kind of like things go pretty bad at Camp 11 pretty quickly.
By Dodger Stadium.
Which is kind of like the first time he got her drunk and she spilled some of her beans. And then the second time, they're like, no, we got to inject you with true serum.
Sodium.
Which, like, yeah. Oh my God, what? It's
pretty rough. Pretty rough.
Give her another glass of wine.
And it was like, it was honestly super fucked up, too.
It was champagne.
That Hasline calls in Dr. Dixon because, and like makes him do that.
Yeah.
Just because he knows that they trust him. And it's just like, I just felt like that was a really fucked up thing to do. And luckily he like stays in the room to like make sure nothing really bad happens.
Right.
But she kind of gives up that, you know, she did some pretty horrifying shit to humans.
Yeah.
In the future, by dissecting them and all that stuff.
I think that it's a really weird thing about these movies in that the first two give the direct parallel of like, hey, here's how we treat others. Mm-hmm. Like, this is something we've done to people. And it is this big pop sci-fi thing. And then they make the bold choice to invert that story and bring the apes into modern society and have them talk about that, have them reckon with it. And the way that this movie is constructed is that we're supposed to, like, kind of judge them for that. In a way that, like, they lose credibility, the way that the narrative is structured.
Judge who exactly?
The apes.
The apes, yeah.
Yeah. But then the panel is like, you know what? We can't judge them for this because we do the same shit.
Exactly. Yeah,
and which is
a,
amazing.
But there's a part of that. They say that, but that's not how, like, the story.
Right, they're still scared of her.
That's not how the story actually progresses.
Yeah.
And I think that that's a really interesting distinction.
Yeah. Well, wasn't the panel actually going to let them live?
Yes.
Yeah.
But
he took it into his own hands.
After he kills the orderly.
They were going to kill the baby always.
They were going to remove the they're going to remove the baby because, and then make
and they were going to sterilize them.
They could never
because kid, this entire story is predicated on like the Oppenheimer of this story basically understanding that they're going to become the dominant species and we need to destroy them, which is the crux of the modern films, spoiler alert, sorry. And I don't know, I feel like that detracts a little bit from the first two films, in my opinion.
Well, we'll see how it goes around in a loop. If it,
I didn't feel like it detracted. I don't know.
What I liked about this one is that it was the most secular of all of them so far.
Despite the actual priest.
Right. The actual priest was only there as a punchline. Otherwise, we really did not talk about religion at all. It was all about politics and science. Whereas the first one had Dr. Zaius was throwing religious stuff all over the place.
Lawgiver.
There was a lot of argument about that there. The second one was about zealots that had formed, you know, a cult of the bomb in the future, but this one was almost completely devoid of religious talk. We're like, you know what? It's all about science at this point.
Oh yeah, and like the second movie, you can argue that the apocalypse is brought about because Zaius is like the lawgiver would never lie to me,
right? Right.
And he rides through fire to be a dumb fuck.
Yeah, religion takes him all the way to the end.
To the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I like this because the whole idea is like, okay, if you were confronted with, you know, literally knowing your future, like, what would you do?
Right.
Would you just be like, hey, maybe we can, you know, like, do we got to just kill these people, make sure it all stops? Or can we figure something else out? Like,
the president even goes through the Hitler dilemma. Yeah,
he goes through all of the permutations of this.
Is it predetermined that you're going to...
Also, frat dudes. Like, they did this in 1972, so you can never have this conversation again.
And by the end, it's like, by the end, we see that, like, even though they tried and thought they stopped everything... They did
Ricardo Montalban. Right.
So yes, let's. So at this point, that was our ape friends are on the run because they've accidentally. That guy. There's no way that guy should have died from getting.
It looked when they cut to him dead on the ground. It looked like he had been shot in the head. And I was
I was like, he just hit his head on the wall.
He's a fragile boy. So what happens is that they're in Camp 11. Everyone knows they're pregnant. Somebody, our Oppenheimer. Nonsense person has said that, like, basically, if this baby is born, we're gonna be fucked.
Yeah,
ever. And they don't really know what's happening with that. Some guy comes in, and they have described that monkey is an insulting term for them,
right?
And the person who's bringing them food says that monkey in your belly, and Cornelius goes ape shit.
That's also probably an offensive term.
How insulting.
Yeah, basically he just flips the tray up and the guy hits his head on the wall.
Yeah, and the guy has an accidental deathly do.
So Dixon and Stevie help them escape, and basically after, you know, walking around, they end up at this freaking, at the pier at like, in like San Pedro at like an abandoned old gross ship, which is crazy. I was like, somebody must have just been like, hey, there's this ship that's like, they're about to knock it down. Should we film something there? Yeah. Yeah. And they're like, oh yeah, the climax is going to take place at this ship.
Okay. But before that, even like, we were talking about this amazing opening sequence and we get the opening titles and everything. And at the end of all the cast members, it says, and Ricardo Montalban as Armando.
I know, I was waiting the whole movie. Like, where the hell is Ricardo Montalban?
Who the hell is Armando? Like, who's he going to be? Is he like the president? Like, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And he as it turns out, he was the Nightmare Alley.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's the greatest showman, obviously.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Okay, yeah.
That would have been great.
We have dueling circus references here.
Yeah, sorry.
So they basically, there's a chimpanzee there with a baby.
Yep.
And I knew there was going to be something about this, but it didn't seem that obvious to me. I thought that our apes were going to either escape or get killed, and that it was going to show that...
Escape.
Zira had taught the baby to that the baby, the actual chimp baby.
That's a better ending, Eliz.
Like that, like this evolution was happening anyway. But instead, they do.
Yes. No, you were not doing enough cocaine in the 70s.
Oh, sorry.
But no, yeah, no. That's a better ending.
That she somehow taught that ape in two seconds to talk. I don't think that's a better ending.
They didn't get enough time after the. You know, after that,
we don't know how long they were there.
When I saw her teaching, I didn't know how much time was going to pass.
It was like,
anyways, they do a switcheroo, they do a baby switch.
Yeah, as soon as she went in there, I was like, she switched the baby.
But that's kind of effed up, also, though.
Yes, it's effed up, but I think it shows how smart she is because she knew that they were going to die. She knew they were probably going to die no matter what. Like, she's smart enough to know that they are not going to get out of the situation.
Or they can come back for the baby if they don't die.
So
That the baby will be safe and people will just think it's a regular chimp and leave it alone and it'll get old enough to the point where someone else can deal with it.
The only reason I agree with everything you're saying, the only reason that I would contest that is that I think that what this entire series is trying to put forward is that knowledge... an understanding of what we're doing can prevent these things. And so if they were there for like 5 months and she taught language to this ape.
But they weren't there for five
months. No, I know. But but when I had this idea, I didn't know that because literally had just happened.
They were
there. Anyway.
Yeah, okay.
So they do a switcheroo so the baby's safe. But then this whole final sequence in the ship is... Well, first of all, Ricardo Montalban's awesome. He's like just immediately flying off the screen, being like just this great character.
I love all these animals. And there's like all these fucking real animals everywhere. You're like, wow, okay.
Yeah. This is nice.
This is where all the budget
and
went.
And the shootout that happens in the San Pedro Harbor is basically an A-Team episode.
Right. It was so crazy. He let really off sad. So many shots. And these two characters... I mean, we kind of are getting the sense that they're about to bite the dust because we just know, but it must have been very, very sad for people watching this in, you know, in the 70s, because these are two characters now that we've had for like three movies.
Yep.
And even though of course they do a few things that we don't like, you know,
never give characters a gun. They're going to die.
Yeah, true.
Well, it's like, you know, and I think it's a testament to like, okay, we get to know a bunch of them in the first movie, the second movie, not so much. Roddy McDowell's not even in it, like some other dude. This movie, you really like. They talked a lot about in the special feature about how Don Taylor really saw, like, the director Don Taylor saw this film as like a love story between these two, Cornelius and Zira. And I feel like that really comes through. Like, you are invested in their relationship, and it's like really sad because you've seen them be so fun and having a. It was like really fun earlier in the film to see them like enjoying all the accoutrements of human life and stuff, and seeing Cornelius in a bathrobe and Zira in a bathtub. Pretty funny. And then to see them go through all this stuff and be excited about the pregnancy and then just get gunned down in like this horrible fashion. And that the guy like shoots the baby like
that was
four or five times.
It's like, it's terrible.
So
it's
messed up. Terrible. And Cornelius falls from that super high level of the ship. It's like, oh
it's
my
just
God.
So sad.
At least he kills the guy too.
Yeah.
Which, you know, of course is bad, but
I mean, I think that there is something to be like processed of understanding what the U.S. did in World War II and Korea and Vietnam, and like to have this person that's the most all-American nonsense to like shoot this baby five times
yeah
is like it's subversive and commendable for this movie that is the third in a franchise to do that.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, it's like, it's also interesting to just see him like become so obsessive that like he is literally the one there doing the killing. Like,
yeah.
Yes. I don't think he ever was like, I need to kill them personally.
And the,
but like, he came,
he, well, because he knows that he's spends, not supposed to be.
He became so obsessed.
And the movie spends time making him likable.
Yeah.
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 He was fine in the beginning.
Yeah.
I know I just said the movie was devoid of religion, but going forward now, we've got like a Jesus or Moses baby hiding in plain sight.
Indeed. And he's got the St. Francis of Assisi medallion that protects animals. Yeah.
That should be interesting.
Spice must flow.
Milo is there in the cage, you know, in a repeating shot over and over again, going like this.
Oh yeah, that was very badly repeated.
Pretty horrifying.
It was really badly repeated, but I do love the tie-in to the mama signal in the first movie.
Yeah,
I was like, it's still good.
Yeah, I it is funny that that ties.
It sounded
doll.
Literally like the same voice as the doll.
I think it was. I think they were really trying for it, but like that is them caring about the franchise in the best that they could in 1972. One.
Yeah. 71. Yeah.
Yeah. But his name right now is Milo.
Milo, which they named after Dr. Milo,
they
which
did,
is very nice.
But supposedly the first ape to speak is supposed to be named Aldo.
Mm-hmm.
So who knows if he'll either end up going by a different
Caesar.
Name or, yeah, we still don't know. I mean, and yeah, in those movies, it's Caesar, right? Yeah. So we'll see what happens.
But I did give me a better respect for those films. I think that there was a lot of things that they were pulling from this one.
Yeah.
It's really interesting.
Yeah, we'll definitely be seeing that in the coming weeks.
That's right. Well, I don't know. Is there anything else you guys want to say before we could move into the rating system?
I don't think so.
How many glasses of Grape Juice Plus would you give?
I love Grape Juice Plus.
I love it. It just makes me tell the truth.
If I had a winery, I would be like, I'm going to
put
this out.
Yeah.
Grape Juice Plus.
Grape Juice Plus.
Escape from the Planet of the Apes.
Oh, yeah, we never made that joke. I guess I'm going to go like 7.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I think it's really good. I liked it a lot more than the last one. It made a lot more sense to me. It's kind of like watching The West Wing or something. You're like, wow, if only government and the president could be this like.
Oh, we're back to trial. Like the first one had so much trial and this one was just like, oh, let's go to the presidential inquiry.
Yeah, I was like, wow, the president actually is all right. Yeah, it's shocking. Anyway. So yeah, and so I really like the concept and, you know, I thought I was going to dislike it more once I figured out what the premise was, but I think they didn't overdo it with the whole like Beverly Hills montage thing. Maybe it would have been too much if he had gone to the Jungle Cruise as much as we would have personally liked to see it.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I mean, I really liked it. I still am like sort of teetering on whether or not I thought the music was too much, but I do think that that's like what makes it a satire.
Yes,
entirely. And it is interesting how this franchise is like jumping genres.
This one is like the largely. Most. This is a Black Mirror episode.
Yeah. And I just didn't see it coming because I've only seen until now when we're doing this tonight, I've only seen some of the new ones, and those are all the exact same tone.
Right.
It's totally playing it straight. There's nothing funny. It's very serious. There's war. There's people dying everywhere.
Waiting for Nirvana to play.
Yeah, it never occurred to me.
Something's in the way.
Yeah, that there would be a complete satire like 70s sitcom entry in this franchise.
Yeah.
So I really liked it.
Well, we had talked about like, when is this going to turn into a camp? But I don't think it's like fully into camp with this, but
no.
But yeah, I think for me, I am going to give it 8 glasses of grape juice plus.
And I think you've had a little too much grape juice plus.
Maybe. It's possible.
I'm just tired. I was like, contemplating like I would almost give it the same score as the first one, which I think we gave all 9s, just because it is such a great, and it's like a, you know, I keep saying genius, but I really feel like it is like for someone to come up with this, and maybe it was on accident or whatever, maybe it was budget focused reasoning or
I
whatever,
think so, yeah,
but it's still just like incredible the way that they made it work,
yeah,
as a total inversion of the first film, and really getting to now have the apes as their protagonists and having their own, you know, version of what happened to Taylor happened to them. And it's just so amazing. I love the Jerry Goldsmith score. Love the opening. Love the performances, everything. And it's just like, I feel like we already had more to talk about of the themes than the last movie where we were kind of like, what are they trying to say? This one, it's a little bit more clear, and I just really enjoyed this movie, and it was a big surprise for me, because I actually don't know if I've ever seen it. So, yeah, this was really good. 8 for me.
I think that this is the hill that I die on for sequel rights.
Uh-oh.
And that I really do believe that this is the first movie came from Fantastic Stories and Sci-Fi Writing magazines and Rod Serling, and the second movie, you know, was trying to capitalize off that success. We have 20 years of TV writers. We have sci-fi at its zenith in terms of all the short story writers, and I think that this type of pivot would never happen today in a way that I really, it feels very pure. Mm-hmm. And it has all of the trappings of something that, like, hey, we did something risky. Here's all the things we're going to throw to make it feel more like mainstream, which is all of the sitcom moments mm-hmm. and everything that happens in the second act. But that also almost makes it more difficult to watch in terms of what happens to them.
Wait, so what's the hill? You think it's better than...
I'm going to say 10.
Oh, my God. No. Okay.
I'm going to say 10.
Hey, okay.
All right.
I don't think it is the best movie, but given the third installation...
It's amazing. A third movie rarely reaches these heights.
And after that last ending, we were like, what are they going
to
do?
To make this dramatic pivot, to try to say some shit and do it in a way that's satirical and also entertaining and also bringing back... like characters that we knew, like I do not think that there has been a third entry to any movie that we've ever talked about.
And I was trying to think
that did this.
And what about Starship Troopers? The third one had that good day to die.
It's a good day to die.
I know, I'm just kidding. But otherwise, that movie was a mess. It was only the song that was great.
This required no catchy.
But actually, those are all satires, Starship Troopers, from the very beginning.
And these are two. And yes. I just think that this is one of those things that probably disrespected by history.
Mm-hmm.
Feels TV related and at the time probably felt cheap.
Right.
But it just leads it so much credence and it leaves that stuff behind to build to a ending that is as subversive as the first film.
Yeah. And I went low right now, but by the time we get to the end, I might be agreeing with you if we're ranking all 10 or whatever movies.
Yeah.
I think that this is a film that was afflicted by the disrespect for television writers.
Yeah, probably. Fair. What does the internet say, Justin?
Well, the good news is that this was another super successful film. It doesn't say in the Wikipedia here, but I believe in the special features they said that the budget was $2 million and that it made $20 million worldwide. So they immediately were like, we need another sequel.
Oh my God. They are turning these out so quick, by the way.
Really
if we didn't make it clear, it's 3 consecutive years.
Yes. So this one, Escape, was out in 71. The next film in the series, Conquest of the Planet of the Apes, was out in 1972. So pretty much right away. One thing they talk about too, like unlike the previous film, there was immediately like everyone who saw the movie was like, what happens to Milo? Like we need to know, like what's going on with Milo? What's he doing? Like what's going to happen? There's immediately like a hook for what to tell for
the next. Not like the last one where we were like, all right, well, I guess it's over.
Yeah. It's like the movie's called Conquest of the Planet of the Apes, and now it's like, okay, are we starting to get more into like how the apes took over now or what?
I gotta love how I think it said some studio executive passed a napkin that was like need more ape movies or whatever. Like, right, yeah. Where it was like
it was a telegram.
Oh, a telegram. program. Yeah, yeah. So it was like, yeah, after that second one, which is amazing. I mean, you got to hate, but also admire the studio executive that was like, oh, they blew up the Earth at the end of that last one. That sounds like a you problem, not a me problem.
It says, the documentary just stated that Arthur P. Jacobs sent beneath screenwriter Paul Dane a telegram concerning the sequel that read, apes exist, sequel required.
Yeah.
That's it.
I mean, like, it's so important to relay to our listeners that, like, we are existing in the world of Marvel and DC and everything else. Like, these shared universes did not exist.
Yeah.
And their ability to string these stories together is not something that people really even cared about at the time.
Well, I mean, they're forcing it.
Yeah, they're forcing it.
And nowadays, we'd be like, well, it's a multiverse. Well, it's a reimagining. Well, it's a DC Elsewheres or whatever.
The ending of the last film would never have happened unless we already, as collective fans, already knew ahead of time that there was like a part two coming.
Yeah.
Well, no, but it would have done anything like
that. But that's why it's important because like the things that they're playing with is the annihilation of the species.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like we're dealing with the atomic age and like that's real. And so the fact that that is the shadow that's cast over this entire series gives it the pathos to play into a lot of different stuff.
It's just funny. Yeah, it's just something like Infinity War where it's like everyone dies at the end, but like you know there's another movie. You literally know there's another movie coming.
Yep.
So like they would never... People these days would never do anything like that without.
Yeah, it's a completely different kind of accomplishment. Yeah. Because yes, this is amazing that they were like, we destroyed the whole world. What about it? But it's also amazing that Infinity War, you're still crying when he's like, I don't feel good, Mr. Stark, even though you know he's gonna come back to life, you know. But you're still like, oh my god,
I'm still feeling the emotions. So, yeah, for sure,
it's two different accomplishments.
Anywho,
let me just say this. Yes. Conquest of the Planet of the Apes is the next film in the Planet of the Apes series. But, you know, first the apes got to take a little detour and get something to drink at the old roadhouse.
They did say the circus was going to Florida.
That's right.
That's true.
That's true. That's a good segue.
And as I've heard, pain don't hurt.
Pain don't hurt. That's right.
Take it outside.
So we have a check-in next week because literally, when you're hearing this, literally the next day, the new Roadhouse remake with Jake Gyllenhaal premieres on Prime Video, directed by Doug Liman. It's going to be interesting. There's been
much drama.
There's a lot to talk about.
We'll talk about it.
Lots of drama. It already played at South By, so there's already a bunch of reviews out and stuff. I'm excited to check it out and see what's going on. It's going to be fun.
We will report if Tinker is involved.
That's right. We need to know. It's been a long time since Roadhouse 2 and when we even talked about those. But yeah, it's going to be a good one.
Oh, God. I think I might have to actually go back and listen to our episodes just to remember what the hell happened.
Yeah, that's
throat ripping is what happened.
So we will be taking a little apes break just to watch some Roadhouse, and then we'll be back with Conquest the week after. But... Yeah.
Do you have any predictions for the Conquest?
For Conquest? I mean, sounds like, if I had to guess, I mean, the only thing seems to be like we're going to follow Milo and he's going to maybe be teaching other apes and trying.
I mean,
he's
going to
run for president.
Oh my God. Yeah. Just based on that title, I mean, I would have thought they can't possibly have anything to do with this, but now that I know how dedicated they are to connecting them, I'm like, yeah, it's got to be Milo.
It's got to be Milo
rising up.
Got to be Milo.
He's young, scrappy, and hungry.
Yeah, it's got to be Milo, and he's
not going to throw away his shot.
No,
he's going to be. They're going to probably skip to him being a full grown adult. I would guess.
Okay.
Maybe we'll skip by any of the like. I don't know. You think we're going to see any of the like? Oh my God! There's still a talking ape. I thought we killed them. Or is it just going to be like?
Honestly, at this point, I am out of the prediction business.
fair.
For this series.
I hope Ricardo Montalban is in it.
I do too.
Yeah, I don't
know. He was really good.
We'll see. It's going to be fun, but we're going to have to wait a couple weeks to find out.
Yes.
But
Ricardo Montalban, not in the Roadhouse reboot.
No. Nope.
Well, in the meantime, crack open another bottle of grape juice plus and send us your... your emails to sequelrights@gmail.com or reach out to us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook at Sequel Rights, and look at our YouTube channel, which now has every episode ever.
Wow!
For your consumption.
Elis, thank you for your service. And please go back, rate and review wherever you're listening. If you already have done that, go back to share out our old episodes. Given what we're talking about next, I would recommend our Swayze double feature,
which
is Roadhouse 1, Roadhouse 2, and all of the permutations of Dirty Dancing, which includes the original film,
Havana Nights,
and a really cringe-worthy TV musical that you should absolutely go watch. And if you don't have the song for that, listen to our episode.
Yes.
And we wait breathlessly for the next Dirty Dancing film that apparently is
coming. Oh my God. Indeed.
And also, don't forget to hang out now and listen to our interview with Hunter Goatley from Hunter's Planet of the Apes Archive.
That's right. We'll see you guys next week and enjoy the interview. All right, we're here with Hunter Goatley, who owns and runs the website Planet of the Apes Archive. And for those who don't know, Hunter, thanks for being here, first of all.
Well, thanks for having me.
It's great for having you. Your website is amazing and filled with so much information.
Yes.
For those who are listening and have not seen the website yet and don't know what it's about, can you give us a little information about your site and how it got started?
Sure. Well, the official name is Hunter's Planet of the Apes Archive, and I never intended for that to be the name. That's very egotistical, which was not my point. It started about 2003. There were a handful of us on one of the Yahoo groups that had a few, I don't even remember now what they were, pictures that we wanted to share with each other. Maybe it was the scripts that started it all. But we needed some place to put it, put the files, because back then there weren't things like WeTransfer and Google Drive and all that stuff. And I actually had access to a system, and I said, well, I can put them up and let them store there. You guys can pull them down. And once I started doing that, people were like, oh, I've got this. Can we share this? Sure. And next thing I knew, I was doing a website, and it grew from there. And despite the name, Hunter's Planet of the Apes Archive, it wouldn't exist if it weren't for all of the dozens and maybe even hundreds, I have no idea, dozens of fans around the world who have been so incredibly generous to share what they have, to send high-res scans of everything that they have so that I can put it up and share it with everybody else, which again is why the name's kind of unfortunate, because I don't actually own very much of what's on there. It came from everybody literally all over the world.
That's so awesome. And, I love that, you know, you got to get this website started early enough that like maybe the first place people go look to find information on Planet of the Apes was your website, and they want to include stuff. That's such a great community to have like built.
Yeah, that's exactly how it happened. You know, the more stuff I added, the more people learned about it, and the more it became kind of the default place to go.
That is the dream of what the internet should be. Yeah. And
yes. Yeah. Well, I've been doing internet stuff for a long time. Yeah. Okay. I was online back in 92. I created the world's first Alice Cooper mailing list and the world's first Kiss mailing list.
Wow.
Amazing.
And I was doing Planet of the Apes stuff. So but the point is that I did get in on the ground floor, but I didn't have enough contacts to be able to do like a news site. Mm-hmm. There was an early Planet of the Apes site called the Forbidden Zone that had they did a really good job of doing news related to Planet of the Apes. And I never wanted to try to compete with something like that, just in part because I didn't have the time. Yep. I didn't have the contacts. So I found this little niche where I could do these sharing the archive files, the scripts and the comic books and the whatever. And fortunately, I've spent the past 20 years, at least the first 10 years, worrying about Fox sending me a cease and desist. Yeah. even though, you know, none of this, I don't charge anything for anything. It's all out there for free. It's stuff that mostly hasn't been available for 40 years or more. So I didn't see why they would, but, you know, I put my disclaimer on and I tried to stay kind of under the radar. But I stopped worrying about it in 2008 when they released the Blu-ray set. And if you recall, the first Blu-ray set came with a big hardback book. And in the back of the book, for internet resources, they listed my website.
Oh, my God.
So I took that as kind of a tacit approval that, you know, they didn't have a problem with it since they were telling people about it.
Yeah, that's so cool.
I love it so much. There's so much great stuff on there. And like I said, it's the promise of what the internet should be and just sharing and community. And I really, really love the time that I've been able to browse through it.
Very good. I'm glad you've enjoyed it. There is a lot out there, and I've forgotten now how many gigs it is, a total of 10, maybe 15 gigs of stuff.
Oh, wow.
So much that over the years, I've can't even remember now everything that's on there.
Yeah.
Every now and then somebody will send something in. It's like, oh, wow, that's really cool. I need to go add that. Oh,
it's already there.
It's already there.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
I'd forgotten. I had no idea.
So you mentioned that a lot of it is like not actually your stuff, but how much is your stuff? How much stuff do you have?
Surprisingly, very little.
Okay.
I've got the original, all the original magazines that Marvel did in the 70s. I've got some things like the press books, the Japanese press books. I've got those.
Oh, cool.
But that's really about it. I had other things that I was collecting, so I didn't seek out a lot of the Planet of the Apes stuff when I actually had some disposable income. but I did buy. I mean, I have a few other things like when I first discovered eBay. That was when I was able to replace a few of the Mego figures that I had had as a kid.
Oh, wow.
That didn't survive. and then two of my goals were to get the trash cans, which I always thought was so cool as a kid, but I don't even remember ever seeing them as a kid. I saw ads about them or saw them somewhere, but anyway, I bought those. So I've got those.
That's amazing.
Okay.
But compared to, you know, so many people that have, you know, actual prosthetic pieces and stuff like that, I don't have anything like that. I do have, this won't be, but you guys can see, this is a chunk of Ape City.
Oh, oh, wow.
That a friend sent me when she visited the site.
Oh, that's so cute.
So that's probably the rarest piece of ape memorabilia I have.
Yeah. Kind of going back to your, I guess, apes origin story, how did you personally like first experience Planet of the Apes and become such a fan?
The first movie I saw was Conquest of the Planet of the Apes at the drive-in.
Wow.
I don't know exactly when it was, 72 or 73. I don't know if it was the first run or if it was, you know, the following summer. I'm pretty sure that the opening film was Frogs.
Yes,
which is a classic.
Yep.
But why we went to see that, I have no idea. My mom took us to the drive-in to see Conquest with Planet 8.
It was Friday.
Planet 8.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I loved that. And then soon after that, I'm pretty sure that I saw Planet of the Apes when it debuted on CBS. Mm-hmm. And then around that same time, of course, is you know, within a year or two, they announced the series and I fell in love with that. So by the time the series hit the air, I was a full-blown ape nut.
That's right.
That's how I found it. So I was, you know, I was a little late. I was born in 64, so I was too young to see the movies in their first run. But I did catch them all on TV and then the series.
What do you think it was about, like, seeing, you know, was it just like an early experience being at the drive-thru and that was what like engrossed you into the Planet of the Apes? Or what do you think it was about the films and later the TV show too, that like really stuck with you and made you want to like collect the figures and all that stuff?
I think it was just the whole idea of talking apes.
Yeah.
It was just cool. It was, you know, it was awesome. At that age, I would have been what, 8 or 9, something like that. So I'm sure that much of the story of Conquest was over my head at the time. But you know, who doesn't love Roddy McDowell playing any of his characters? Mm-hmm. So that's what I remember is just the talking apes and just everything about it, the aesthetics, the look, the costumes, the way the makeups looked, everything was just so cool. And that's really what sparked it all.
There's something about a sci-fi film or a genre film where you can tell that, you know, people are putting effort into making a world around.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I think that we all come to those. There's a certain age when that happens. But when somebody is doing the work of rallying all these effects artists and everything else to like manifest something that feels different in that way, it's just right. So powerful. And
I agree.
These movies are incredible in that way. I wish that I could have seen it in the drive-in in that way.
Yeah.
There's a magic to that.
Yeah, that would have been so fun.
Yeah. As you were talking about that, I kept thinking of Logan's Run.
Yeah.
That was another one where I think the world building was just excellent. You know, now I know it was shot in a Dallas shopping mall and places, but
yep.
I didn't know that then. And it had, they did a great job of that world building that Planet of the Apes did.
Yep.
For each of the films, they were able to do that world building and make it, you know, to sell it. They make the first film, they really make you, at least I believe, they really make you believe it was another planet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it was a shock when you found out it was Earth because I bought into it. They did a good job of hiding that. and at some point too, I'm sure, Escape probably had a whole lot to do with cementing my enthusiasm for it because, you know, the idea of turning that story around on its head and the whole montage with the city scenes and stuff and going to the banquets and all that, it was just wonderful. You know, yeah. Talking apes in my environment. <You know>? Yeah.
That was a fun one. That's the one we're talking about this week. It's gonna be a good convo.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a great film. And it's amazing to me that these films were so dark.
Yeah.
And nihilistic and rated G.
Yes.
Except for Conquest. But it's hard to imagine a movie where, like Escape, and I'm not going to spoil it, even though you're about to talk about it and stuff, but it... You know, it's like just when you think it can't get any darker, it does.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's like, wow, what a bummer.
The ratings were so different back then.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think that was part of the appeal for me too, though. I don't like dark downer movies and stuff, mm-hmm. but the Apes movies felt real. They felt the dark endings to these things felt like, you know, it's not a good world.
Yep.
Humans blew it up. Yep. And all this is leading to that. And it's just, it works for me more than other films that just, you know, celebrate darkness to be dark.
It feels like a parable, right? It feels like that this can happen and we don't want it to. And so yes. like this is us. Let's look in the mirror at the worst versions of ourselves. As
right.
we move forward on this, but also the best versions, because that makes it scarier, right? It's like
yes.
people trying to do the right thing, but in this world, this thing happens, and it's inevitable. And there's something really powerful about that kind of limbo between the thing that's going to happen and the thing that could be happening. And it just allows for them. And it's to the credit of the writers and the filmmakers, they didn't just go for the easy stuff here. I mean, in Escape, we were taking bets on, you know, like, what's going to happen next? What's going to be in this thing? Because a lot of us hadn't seen all these in order, or we have them all in, you know, the collective unconscious of all of the story that's kind of seeped through osmosis, or we saw it on cable and forgot and everything else. And I was stunned kind of that they made this choice for Escape and went everywhere that they went. It's really, it's everything that I love about filmmaking. It's really fun.
Yeah. Yep. I agree. That's very good.
While we're on the topic of the films, you know, it seems like your site mostly deals with the original run of films, but are you a
very
fan
proudly
of the recent ones at all? Okay, so all right, so yeah,
you now don't like I will say, ones, or do you? There is a certain film that does not exist for me. I do my best to not have anything related to that on the site. There are, unfortunately, a handful of magazine articles that appeared in 2001 that were related to the original series. So you will find a couple of covers that have the unmentionable on the cover. But the articles are just the original. And I made that decision back, you know, in 2003 when I kicked off the site. It's like, I hate that movie. I am not going to have anything to do with it.
Yep.
And then when the new movies came along, I actually like the new movies. Okay. They're not Planet of the Apes.
Yep.
They are, but they are good films telling a story about these apes.
Okay.
Which I'm okay with. But there's so much stuff for that and so many other sites with stuff for that, that I didn't see any reason to try to incorporate all that into the site either. So
that's fair.
Yeah.
Fair,
absolutely.
Yeah. So mine is very proudly, just the original five movies and two TV shows.
Nice. What's going back to the website that features all the stuff from the original films, what's like your personal favorite item that you featured on the site?
This is kind of weird to say because of how I'm about to say it. But it started with sharing the scripts, and the fact that we have all these scripts that, that people have shared, there are different drafts of different ones. They're, the drafts that, you know, for movies that didn't actually get made, they're unpublished, TV scripts that weren't made. Now the funny part about that is that I haven't read most of those, but I love that they're there. And I love that that's part of the site that I'm able to host all of these things, because there are people who read them and love them. I've just never made the time to do so.
Yeah.
But there's that. And then the second part is, there's a huge section of the site, Mark Talbot Butler's Ginormous Stills Collection. Mm-hmm. And it's over 2,000 high quality stills that Mark scanned. Mark was a huge fan in the UK. He was a film editor, but he died a couple of years ago. And but he was just incredibly generous, always on the hunt for these stills, and always sending me, you know, these high res versions to put on there to share with the fans. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I decided way back when too. I hate sites who share things like that, but slap their own watermarks on them.
Yeah.
Or, you know, from the collection of, you know, whatever. Right. No. The downside to that is people take from the site all the time and share it on places and don't tell people. And my thing is not, I don't want the credit for the stuff, but if you're sharing this thing you took from my site, why don't you say, this came from this website. Mm-hmm. Check it out. There's a lot more there.
Yeah.
And not enough people do that. It irritates me.
Yeah.
As it should. And like the still collection there and all those scans are gorgeous. They're very worth going through. And
yeah.
I didn't know that about his passing, and it's incredible work. And I would say anybody listening to this that has a modicum of interest in this series, definitely go check those out. It's well worth your time.
So those were two very nice and very earnest answers to the question, but I'm also wondering, like, cause there's so much merch and toys and weird things that are there. Like, what is like the quirkiest or the silliest or weirdest thing that like people are always asking you about, like something that Planet of the Apes has been slapped onto that's strange or something like that?
Yeah, the collectibles page has pictures of most of the merchandise that came out, and there is a lot of weird stuff out there. the weirdest are probably either the motorcycle riding Zaius, or the paratrooper Zaius, and Cornelius is one of them. The really fun ones are the ones like those are both, you know, they were generic rack toy manufacturers who bought the license to slap Planet of the Apes on their toy. So, you know, your $6 million man walkie-talkie is also a Planet of the Apes walkie-talkie because they put a sticker on it.
Yep.
Those things are fun. The big fuzzy slippers are pretty fun. I don't know. But again, I don't own a lot of that stuff. Yeah. I didn't have any of that as a kid.
Yeah.
I had some of the Migos, mm-hmm. and that was pretty much it. The models. I had Zeus and Cornelius models as well.
Oh, cool.
But that was about all I had as a kid. So I don't have that nostalgic connection to all the merchandise that some people have. Which is why probably why I'm not able to give you the answer that you were really looking for.
Oh, no, it's great. And yeah. I enjoyed looking at that page. Funny. Yeah. Just wondering, are you familiar with that Simpsons episode with the Planet of the Apes? Do you like it? Do you think it was funny? Like,
no, I thought it was hilarious. Yeah. Yeah.
Because we've been singing that to ourselves every week.
There are some... There are a couple of other spoofs. One of the things that I did just a couple of weeks ago, now I'm going to make this story a little longer, going back to the mid-2000s, one of the projects that we were doing in the Yahoo group, I had a DVD burner. Mm-hmm. Few people had DVD burners at the time.
Yep.
But I had a burner and I had authoring software. And I knew there was all this Planet of the Apes stuff out there. But how do you share it with people? So I volunteered to create some DVDs. And once again, I had people from all over the country sending me their VHS tapes, loaning me their VHS tapes. I recorded this, you know, whatever, this little snippet from Entertainment Tonight.
Okay.
So they'd send it and I would collect the best of those things. And I released three Planet of the Apes rarities DVDs
Wow.
that are just full of stuff like that. Oh, man. And then they were sold, not sold, they were given away to people.
That's right.
Would send in a blank disc and they'd get the disc burned in return.
Oh, nice.
And I made sure that, you know, we weren't selling it. We weren't making any money on it because I didn't want any kind of hassles about that.
Right.
Naturally, eBay being what it is, there were a few people who took those and were selling them and made me mad again. Those things basically have just, you know, languished in my collection for 20 years. And just a couple of weeks ago, I uploaded the vast majority of those clips to my YouTube channel.
Oh, great.
Oh, man.
Which is linked on the website.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's just Hunter Goatley YouTube at Hunter Goatley. So, okay.
And that link will be in the show notes. We will definitely direct some folks towards that.
Yeah.
Okay. But there's so many great things in there. There are some spoofs, which is what started this was the Simpsons bit. I also included, and I'm hoping that nobody, well, actually this one is not on YouTube because it was rejected for copyright claim, but it's on my website, the Charlton Heston Saturday Night Live when he hosted.
Yes.
Where the show starts with him falling asleep beforehand and waking up and everybody's apes.
Yeah.
For reasons I don't know, if you go to Peacock and try to watch that episode, it starts with the monologue. And there's like a 5 or 6 minute bit at the beginning that they omit.
Oh, weird.
And I have it now on my website.
Okay.
That is so funny because I have been watching through all of the old SNLs on Peacock and I watched that episode and I did not know that. So I am definitely going.
Well, you'll have to go check it out because it's brilliant.
Oh, speaking of hidden. Go ahead.
Well, in addition to a couple of spoofs, there's a ton of stuff there. AMC and Sci-Fi Channel and something else had contracted with Roddy McDowell and Charlton Heston and Kim Hunter to do introductions and bumpers
Oh, cool.
For various marathons. Oh, wow. So I've got all of those on there. I have the unedited, the raw sci-fi reels for Sci-Fi Channel with Roddy McDowell. Oh my God. So it's like an hour and 20 minutes of all the behind the scenes, you know, all the multiple takes of Roddy goofing these things up or rewording or whatever it was that he did.
Yeah.
So there's a ton of fun stuff there.
Cool.
So I encourage everybody to check it out. And again, that's linked from the website, from my website.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That sounds amazing. I mean, so we're going to direct everybody there. I would like, you have so much knowledge about this world, and you mentioned the Marvel comics and you mentioned the TV show. I wonder if people are going on this journey with us and this is their first time through the Apes universe, if there's anything outside of the original films that's not, you know, the version that shall not be mentioned or the new films that you'd encourage, you know, some of our listeners to go check out. I've read through some of those original 70s Marvel comics. We have not jumped into the TV show, but I have found copies of it and I am intending to do so. But I think that just maybe your favorite story or maybe a little corner of the universe to point people towards.
Well, probably again, because these are one of the items that I owned some of them. I didn't own all of them at the time. But I think the Marvel magazines pretty much encapsulate everything that was Planet of the Apes in the 70s. Like the scripts, I haven't actually read all of the comics that are in those, and they got pretty weird.
Yes.
So some of the comics got really out there. But they started the first, I don't know how many issues of the magazine. They were just doing comic adaptations of the movies. And those are interesting if you haven't seen them, because they weren't allowed to use the likenesses of the actors. And some of them were taken from different drafts of the script. So they're not exactly like the movies, which is fun. Mm-hmm. But more than that, the thing that I really loved about all those were the articles that they did, at least for the early run. Later on, they were mostly comics. But the first, I don't know how many dozen issues or so, they had a big section of articles in the middle. And there were things like on the set of Battle for the Planet of the Apes. And they were talking about, you know, that all the stuff that they filmed underground and the problems they had with airplanes flying overhead. They had to wait for those and stuff like that. And I just found that fascinating as a kid, just reading these articles, reading how the makeup was done, reading all that stuff. So I think a sort of an answer to the question is, for somebody who's new to all this stuff, I would highly recommend you check out those Marvel magazines, all of which are on the website. You can download them in PDF or CBZ formats. You just get a real feel for what it was like to be a Planet of the Apes fan in the 70s from those.
That's so cool. All right, Hunter. Well, we don't want to take up too much of your time here, so just wanted to, you know, say thank you so much for being here with us to talk about this.
Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, it's so great to hear, like, you know, your enthusiasm for the property come through, and it's like, it's just such an amazing, like, absolute treasure trove of stuff that you have compiled on Hunter's Planet of the Apes archive. If listeners want to go check out the archive, where can people do that? Can you give everybody the web address?
Sure. It's pota.goatley.com, and that's GOATLEY.com. And then that also stems from back when I first started, it was expensive to have your own domain name. Since I already had goatly.com, I just used pota.goatly.com.
Indeed it was, yes.
Yeah, and so, you already mentioned your YouTube, but are there other, I know you're pretty active on Facebook. Are there other social medias that you're on?
Facebook's the only one where I do anything apes related. I do have a Hunter's Planet of the Apes archive page there. Anytime I update anything, I post there. I also occasionally share other things that I see on Facebook that don't necessarily fit the site, but I think people would be interested in seeing. So there's that. And sorry, I thought of something else a second ago, and I'm trying to remember now what it was that I was going to say. There is one other thing that I would like to point out, because I don't think many people realize they're there.
Okay.
There are sub-sites of my site where I have rescued sites that went away. sites cool. that for various reasons, did the people stop maintaining them? There are, I've forgotten how many are there, 5 or 6. Back in when the movie that shall not be named was being made, there was a countdown site that Alex Ruiz did called Prophecy Site. And mm-hmm. he did a lot of work paying tribute to the original films in anticipation of this new one, with all kinds of QuickTime videos and stuff that are really, lo-fi right now, but to us now, but at the time were just amazing.
Yeah.
And with his permission, when he stopped doing the website, with his permission, I restored it as a sub-site of my site. The Forbidden Zone that I mentioned, mm-hmm. that was one of the things I did this last summer. Nice. I spent hours and hours crawling through the Wayback Machine, finding all the files that I could to recreate that site, because they had a lot of great information on it. And information that isn't readily available on my site, because that's not the kind of site I was doing.
Wow. Credits and stuff like that. The lawgiver's work.
That's right.
Tyler, you stole my joke.
I had it in the chamber.
All right. Yeah.
And then the last thing, there are two other things that I'm pretty proud of that I actually saved them at the time. When they did the VHS release, Fox had a site devoted to that. And then when they did the Blu-ray release, they had a site devoted to that. And I saved both of those way back when, and those are both there now, too. Nice. So if you want to see what it was like in 1998 when Fox was releasing the DVDs, it's all there.
Oh, cool. Absolutely.
That's so great. So, it's like, yeah, you're doing like the digital historian archaeology stuff. Yeah. It's amazing.
It's incredible work. And as an early internet fan, I commend you.
Thank you.
It's really wonderful.
Yeah.
Thank you. And again, most of the credit really goes to the fans all over the world who are happy to share their stuff. They spend a lot of time scanning this stuff and taking photos, and I appreciate it. I get the fun of trying to organize it and make some sense. But
and paying the hosting fees.
That's right.
So, but thank you for having me on. It's been great talking about this stuff, and I hope other people find it interesting, because I never expected to be doing this, but here I am 20 years later.
That's really great.
Yeah. Well, there's new movies still being made. So there's clearly still fans out there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
People yet to discover your site. So
hopefully
everyone can go check out Hunter's Planet of the Apes archive.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.